coming to you live.
Live.
It's a Sid Rosenberg show.
Say the full name of the listing you want.
640 Sports.
I listen to it 24/7.
The rock of the world.
Sid Rosenberg.
Sid Rosenberg is on.
First ball swinging, drills one in the air to deep left center, hustling towards the gap is Cespedes. He can't get it. It's off the base of the wall, rolls along the warning track. He could go all the way here. Escobar to third. He's being waved home. Flores will not make a relay throw. It's an inside-the-park home run by Alcides Escobar on the first pitch of the game, delivered by Matt Harvey.
You know, I didn't feel great. I didn't have my good stuff, but, you know, obviously, if I kept the two runs off the board in the sixth, you know, it might be a different ball game. So, you know, for me, it's obviously a disappointment. But like I said, we got to get back out there tomorrow. And, you know, obviously I'm going to have another start, so I'll be ready for it.
Swing and a drive in the air, deep to center. Back goes Cespedes at the wall. It's going to go. A home run for Alex Thornton. And the Royals have tied the game 4-4 here in the bottom of the ninth inning.
When I got in the box, I just wanted to make sure I was ready to go and not be surprised by it. And, you know, he did it and left me, you know, a good pitch to hit. And with a guy like that, you just can't let those go by, and you got to make sure you put good wood on it. And that's what I did.
The one thing he doesn't do is give up home runs. So we were all shocked by it. You know, tomorrow night in the same situation, he'll be back out there.
Like I say, tomorrow is a new day. I don't think about it. He got a good swing, my fastball, what I miss in the zone. And tomorrow is a new day. I move forward and doing my job tomorrow.
Swinging a high fly ball deep to right field. It should end the game. Granderson settling under it. He makes the catch. Escobar tags. Here he comes. Granderson's throw to the plate. Not in time. And the Royals win game one of the World Series.
I was just ready, whatever the team needs. I mean, that's been my role all season. And whether it's starting or relieving, just trying to help this team win. And what a great game. Mets are a tough team, and we've got our work cut out for us. But tonight was huge.
Two things you don't want in game one of the World Series, and one of them is to go 14 innings, and the other one is to lose. So, you know, to find a way to grind that game out against a great team over there. I mean, they were both teams were matching pitch for pitch. We had opportunities. They'd make big pitches and get out of innings. You know, to grind through that game and to win it in the 14th inning was big.
I heard stories. You used to keep a book on umpires. You were very smart that way.
Well, a little more than that. I said, I need these umpires. So what do? I just pull $500,000 and I hired a private investigation team. Paul, their blood's just as red as ours. Some of them like women. Some of them like men. Some of them gamble. Some of them do whatever.
So you had PIs tracking umpires through your career or just a few years?
No, like when after I got the money, you know, when I was trying to get the money. It wasn't a coincidence you think that I led the league in walks the next few years, was it?
So you really think...
I don't think, I know.
Did you bribe him?
No, his fear does a lot to a man. Hey, so did you cover last night? He called it a strike. Oh, I don't think you heard me. Did you cover the spread last night? Next.
Have you told anybody else's?
You're the first one, man. And one of my book. It gets better.
But basically you're saying you had a dossier on umpires and you found, you know, if they were cheating around on their wife or doing something like that?
Hey, look, I had to do what I had to do to win and to support my family.
I'm Eric Reed, joined by another Heat original, my broadcast partner, the coach, Tony Fiorentino, and we're both really looking forward to this season. This is a team that's really got a great opportunity to compete and contend. This starting lineup that they're going to start with this year didn't play together at all a year ago. What does that mean to the coach and for the players to know you've got a consistent go-to starting group?
Coach Spoelstra is like Hall of Fame coach Pat Riley. He likes to put five names on the board. They know their role. They know that they're going to be starting. If those guys stay healthy, they can be arguably the best starting five in the NBA.
This is a starting five the Heat are excited about, a group led by Chris Bosh. An important offseason. He's back at full strength and recovered from the blood clots that cost him 30 games last year. What are you expecting out of this healthy return from a rejuvenated Chris Bosh?
Well, we know he's arguably the most versatile big man in the NBA. He's got many skills, but he also is a leader both on and off the court. His enthusiasm and his perspective now is even more than it used to be. That's going to be contagious for this team, and he's another go-to guy that he can rely on.
I think Miami is just an absolutely terrible job. I think this program is bankrupt. I think it has a delusional fan base thinking that this is the 80s and the 90s and maybe even the early part of the new millennium. I don't get it. I don't know why any coach in their right mind would want this job. You have all these former players, and their names are well known. They're tweeting. They want some ownership in the program, and they're not going to be they're not going to accept just some run of the mill coach. Nor will they get a big name coach. I mean, you said maybe entice a coach. But I'd like to know who you're talking about, because what legitimate coach would walk in there with one of the worst stadiums in America with no fan base whatsoever unless they can be a proven winner, which they can't be on day one? I mean, Al Golden was a pretty good hire, and he failed miserably.
This debate will offer Trump his first moment where he's not the absolute unquestioned frontrunner. He is nationally the frontrunner, now trails Ben Carson in Iowa. He's already gone on the attack against Carson, mentioning his religion, then backing off and saying, I don't want to talk about people's faith. But he clearly brought that up in Iowa because he is worried about the rise of Ben Carson. He's going to go negative on him. What does he do in the debate? Does he blow up at Ben Carson and really go after him? Should be a good forum for him, though. It's jobs. It's the economy. That's his bailiwick. So it's an opportunity for him. And then, obviously, the other candidates have a lot of work to do to get into that top tier with those two guys.
Well, especially Bush. There have been questions raised about his campaign at this point. The need to cut back by 40% their salaries. Where does that leave him?
It leaves him in not a great position. Obviously, he's raised a lot of money. The Super PAC has a lot of money. His campaign committee has something like $13 million money-wise. He's fine, but his poll numbers haven't moved. He's still mired well back in the field. Marco Rubio has gone up above him. He needs a breakout moment. It's hard for him in debates, though, because he tends to give long answers that are very policy-oriented, speaks in full paragraphs. Not very good in debates. Trump, very good in debates, because he can give you that punchy, quick, fast answer. Does Jeb Bush have a path forward? I don't know the answer to that. There's not a great market for establishment politicians in this field. Look at Trump, look at Carson. Those are the people doing well. Still early, though. Talk to me when the voting starts.
Well, Trump took shots at Bush this weekend, too. Bush was going to convene with his family to really try and figure out what to do about it.
Right. But yeah, I think the headline should be Trump take shots at insert X candidate, because he's going to take shots at everybody. But he has sort of moved his fire from Jeb, who is not that big of a threat right now, to Carson, who clearly is. But who knows what will happen in the debate. He'll probably go after everybody a little bit. You never know what you're going to get with him, whether you get, you know, big punching Donald Trump or laid back Donald Trump. His people want, you know, the high energy, go after everybody thing. So I think he'll bring that.
So you think you can tell heaven from hell, blue skies from pain? Can you tell a green field from a cold steel rail? A smile from a veil? Do you think you can tell? Did they get you to train your heroes for ghosts? Hot ashes for trees? Did you exchange a walk-on part in the war for a lead role in a cage?
Disaster today. No sleep. Now, let me start off again. I do this often. I know I do. Give me a little more juice over there, Eric. I know I do, but I am in a rotten mood today. This could be the worst ever.
What could possibly have you in a rotten mood this morning?
Right. There's no sleep. I'm at loss. And what a dick.
Lingell.
What are you talking about? What happened
now? He knows we're both not in good moods. He goes, why? You're not in a good mood?
Well, you particularly are in a really, it's actually silly. I mean, it's one game. It's not, if we were down 3-0, I would react the way you are today. It's fine. People lose World Series games.
Yeah, but it was,
you don't sweep.
We won the game.
It's fine. We didn't win the game. We move on. We got the best pitcher on our team pitching tonight. The whole idea is you split the first two games. You very rarely go on the road and win the first two anyway. Did the Mets blow an opportunity last night? Yes. But if your best pitcher wins tonight, you go back to Queens 1-1 on Friday, you're in great shape. You're acting this one like we're down 3-0. I mean, God, you got to calm down. It's silly. We blew the game, but it happens.
What happened when Armando Benitez blew game one?
This is a much better team than that team.
I agree 100%.
And the Yankees were a lot better then than the Royals are right now. So let's just take a deep breath. It's a bad loss. They had the game. They were two outs away from winning game one on the road in the World Series. I get it. And it's bothering me, too. But what bothered me more is I had to wait another five freaking innings. 14th inning, 1 o'clock in the morning to finally go to bed when they actually did lose the game. But I knew once Gordon hit the home run in the bottom of the ninth, we were done. I had zero confidence we were winning that game in extra innings.
I had confidence going into in the 10th when we had runners. We had someone on third with one out, and Michael Kadire, the worst player in baseball history. This guy is... Why is he even on the roster?
He won a batting title a couple of years ago.
Get him off the roster.
But he's the worst player in the history of Major League Baseball?
Where was Juan Uribe?
Is he hurt?
He's on the roster. I don't want to see Michael Kadire even in the dugout. Leave him in the clubhouse. He is so bad. He was swinging when the ball would be in the pitcher's mitt. He would swing after.
I saw that, yes. It was very, very unfortunate and bad. I agree with you.
He would swing after the ball.
He was a little behind the fastball. I did see that, yeah.
The ball was in the mitt.
But you see, Kadire, I understand. I know the Mets gave him $10 million a year for 2 years, and this is not Coors Field. He didn't lead the league in hitting this year. It was a lost season, and maybe it's over for Michael Kadire. But the guy that's really bothering me is Cespedes. The guy cannot get a big hit. He can't. He started the game last night. He was back in the locker room something, so he missed the pregame introductions. And say what you want about that first play. That was awful. That wasn't bad. That was awful. And don't tell me about the bright lights and he was nervous. I don't want to hear any of that garbage. He played in the playoffs last year for Oakland. He's been garbage for weeks. Had a couple of home runs early in the series against the Dodgers. Did nothing at the end of the Dodgers series, was invisible for the Cubs series, and had an awful blunder last night. So this guy's a free agent, and he's going to get tons of money somewhere, and the Mets are not going to bring him back. But even whoever does sign him, the last couple of weeks, he's losing money. Cespedes is, and I don't, listen, he carried the Mets. It was no coincidence that when the Mets got him, we won the NL East. He was the guy. For 2 months, he carried the team. He really did. But this postseason, he's losing money by the game. By the game?
No, 100%. Anyone looking at this guy right now is, every time he goes up, he's hacking for the fences. Can you just get a base hit?
Just hit the ball. Yeah.
There was a point up there. We had runners on one of the corners or first and second.
Like Michael Kadire.
Get a base hit.
Maybe he's the worst player ever. Cespedes, ever. Leaving runners on base and scoring position.
Michael Kadire.
Yeah, he's public enemy number one today on this show, just so you know. He has replaced Osama bin Laden and Barack Obama, who I put in the same sentence. Yes, I did. As public enemy number one on the Sid Rosenberg Show today, Michael Kadire. What can you tell me about Michael Kadire, Eric Langell?
He's the worst baseball player in history. I just heard it myself. He swings at balls when they're in the mitt.
Right. Behind like the fastball just a little, yes.
I like that.
Yeah.
Why did we play Roger Waters at the beginning of the show? I thought we were on a protest.
No, I can't do it. I still love Pink Floyd.
He came out against Stern, by the way.
So you're going to go to a Tarantino movie next.
Yes,
right?
I am.
No,
yes,
no,
I am.
No, no,
yes.
No, no.
No, yes, I am.
Yeah.
There's a very good movie coming out. Very good.
It actually looks
discipline. He can't boycott anything.
Right. Unlike Derek Jeter said way back when that he's going to concentrate on baseball as long as he plays baseball. So he didn't get married. He wasn't going out to clubs. He went out often, trust me, but not every single night. He was the prototypical, I'm going to go to work every single day, play shortstop, and be a great baseball player. And now that he's retired 1 year, he's been dating the supermodel Hannah Davis for 3 years. Now he's getting engaged. Now he's getting married. Derek Jeter. He is the epitome of discipline. We, on the other hand, are not. We're just not. We yell and scream about something, and then we go right back to it.
Well, you have to sacrifice to boycott.
What have I sacrificed in your life lately? Yeah.
Lately, wow.
Yeah, because I mean, it's fine if you want to bash me for this. But
No. Well, I haven't made.
I mean, I remember when you were angry with Ray Rice, really angry, and you were angry with Greg Hardy, and you're still watching the NFL. So,
Not much.
Oh, yeah, right.
I've cut
You're traveling to a game this weekend.
You're going to the Warriors to see the Giants play the Saints.
Well, he's not on either team, Greg Hardy.
Very good point, yes. Because there are no gangbangers or thugs or bad guys on the Saints. Not one. Not even one.
Not the Saints.
No, not the Saints.
No.
No, that's why they're called the Saints.
They're Saints.
That's right.
Very saintly behavior.
Well said. Wow.
What have you sacrificed in your life? Are you angry about something? You're angry, so you boycotted something. What have you done?
Oh, well, I've boycotted Keeping the Kardashians, and I am Kate.
And why is that?
Because I'm not a fan.
Caitlyn Jenner.
Yes.
But so because of Caitlyn Jenner, you boycotted the Kardashians, or the Kardashians you boycotted before that?
Before that, yes.
What made you angry about them?
Just them in general.
Yeah.
Their whole...
They seem to annoy you.
Yeah, they annoy me. Yeah. So I don't know. That's about it, though.
That's it?
I haven't really felt the need.
See, I am guilty of being a hypocrite. I yell and scream, and then I go right back to it. I can't help myself.
I was willing to go along with the Pink Floyd boycott.
Right.
And
what happened?
The Tarantino boycott, but I was told to play it this morning.
I did tell you to play that. It's all my fault. I apologize. What happened with Roger Waters and Howard Stern now? What's the latest?
Waters responded to Stern. Yeah. Ripping him out and, you know, just being a moron.
Right.
Just being a delusional, alcoholic, old man. Nothing more than that.
Nothing new. I remember that interview so well. The first time Roger was live in studio with Stern. It wasn't good. It was great. And they got along great. You could tell Stern loved Pink Floyd and loved Roger, and Roger he enjoyed Howard, and now they despise each other. They hate each other.
And I appreciate Roger Waters' music, even his solo career after Pink Floyd.
Yeah. Hey, Garrett, don't be afraid to pick up the phone as you're staring at the red light blinking.
I mean, Jesus.
I see the kid staring at the phone like, do I pick that up? What do I do? There's a red light blinking. And there he goes. Excellent job. Garrett Phillips.
Nah.
Oh, no intern.
I did warn him. He will get called out on the air if he doesn't answer the phone right away.
Right away. It rang 100 times.
I know.
I was giving him a few minutes. I was looking
Langell
back.
Langell was looking back there for 5 minutes.
I didn't even realize
from this point of view.
I didn't want him to suffer this humiliation, but he didn't wise up fast enough.
No. So besides the Mets in the Open, the Miami Heat open up their season tonight. They will host the Charlotte Bobcats. The very lovely Chelsea Taylor, who works at our sister station, the country station, WIRK. She went to the Taylor Swift concert last night in Miami.
Big.
Yes, very big.
A lot of posts.
She told me that Ricky Martin was invited up on stage.
I think Pitbull showed up.
And Dwayne Wade.
That was D. Wade, huh?
D. Wade even gave Taylor Swift a Heat jersey last night.
Very nice.
Isn't that exciting?
I'm sure she hasn't got one in every city so far.
Right, I'm sure she
She can just throw it in the box with the other 20.
Are you assuming she's banging a basketball player on every...
No, not Taylor Swift. She goes for a different kind of guy.
Oh, I got you.
Yeah.
Oh, the Heat start their season tonight hosting Charlotte on Friday in Cleveland for James and the Cavaliers, who did open the season last night in Chicago, losing to the Chicago Bulls 97-95. LeBron, how did LeBron do last night? Let's take a look.
They played?
Yes, they did. They lost 97-95 to Chicago.
Wow.
Derrick Rose had 18 for the Bulls and complained of blurred vision after the game. LeBron James had 25 points in 38 minutes. Three games last night. Detroit all over Atlanta. The Bulls edged the Cavaliers. And the world champions, the reigning world champs, and the reigning MVP, Steph Curry and Golden State, blew out New Orleans, beat them by 16. And Steph Curry put in 40 last night. Anthony Davis, who a lot of people think may be the second best player in the league behind LeBron James, shot 4 of 20 from the floor. Had 18 points in the loss.
It's early.
Pelican basketball. You love it, don't you?
I've been a fan for years.
You're a diehard fan.
I've been for like 20 years.
Back then it was the New Orleans Jazz. Pete Maravich. That's your love when you were growing up as a kid, right?
That was the team, yes.
What else was in the open today? So we did the Mets. We did the Heat we just talked about. Well, Lenny Dykstra. This is amazing stuff. Yesterday, Lenny Dykstra, the former great New York Met and Philadelphia Philly, on with Colin Cowherd, who is on this station every single day after me and Dan Patrick, noon to 3 each and every day here. Lenny Dykstra, a guest on Colin Cowherd's show yesterday, said that he actually paid a private investigator $500,000 to get dirt on all the Major League Baseball umpires. So, for example, Lenny would be at the plate, and there'd be a pitch that Lenny thought was a ball. The umpire would call it a strike. Lenny would turn around based upon the information the PI gave him and say, "Hey, your team cover last night?" And the ump would say nothing. The next pitch would come, another strike call. Lenny would turn around again and go, you don't want your wife to know you lost $5,000 on the Giants last night, do you? And then, of course, the rest of the game, all the calls would go Lenny's way. He said to Colin Cowherd, he said, umpires are red-blooded, just like all of us are. Some of them like women, some like men, some like to gamble, some do drugs. And in the end, Lenny Dykstra had dirt on just about every umpire through Major League Baseball. And he says, it's no coincidence, after signing his big four-year contract extension with the Phillies before the 1993 season, that for about three straight years, he led the league in walks. That was an amazing revelation, an unbelievable conversation between Colin Cowherd and Lenny Dykstra yesterday.
And if you look at Colin's face, Colin's almost like,
he's
this
like,
real?
Oh, my God, really?
Is this the first time? Yeah.
You're the guy. First time.
And Colin's like, what is going on here? Is this really happening?
Of course, he's like, my name in headlines across the country after this one.
I mean, he's got a bunch of, there was a bunch of other clips in there, like, he showed he has no teeth. He lifted up his mouth.
So nasty.
He got knocked out.
I think he's kind of losing it.
No, he's not kind of losing it. He's been crazy for years. He's been jailed a million times. He's been arrested for fraud, bankruptcy.
He reminds me of Busey in a way.
He's worse.
He's just.
His career as a very good player was riddled with gambling, Atlantic City, tons of money, drug abuse, tons of cocaine. I mean, the guy was just a complete mess. So that's Lenny Dykstra on with Colin Cowherd yesterday.
That was great.
Paul Feinbaum was at the open, too. This goes out to Victor Bermudez and Laz from Cutler Ridge and all these morons, and I mean that sincerely, the morons, who for years and years do their stupid U hand signal, yelling and tweeting about the U, telling us how great the U is. That's Paul Feinbaum, who is a national guy, as respected when it comes to college football as anybody in the country, has, as far as I know, no personal bone to pick with Miami and Coral Gables, saying, quote, who would want that job? Quote, they've got no fan base. That was his quote. No, which I've said for years. I said that back at QAM. They have no fan base. No, Chris Jones, talk Miami, baby. It's all about the U. Nobody cares. Nobody.
He even ripped a stadium he got in there.
It is a garbage stadium. Yeah. And the facilities there suck.
And if you're a student at UM, you want to travel 45 minutes north to go watch a game?
Don't even have your own stadium. Winners of five national championships, you have to drive 45 minutes north to share your stadium with the Dolphins. It's a joke. It's a joke. Stop with this, it's all about this, and your stupid hand signals. It's over. And I was happy to hear Paul Feinbaum make that point yesterday. And, of course, the other big story today is a debate, the third debate taking place in Colorado later on tonight. And the question becomes, now that Ben Carson has gone ahead of Donald Trump nationally, will Donald Trump come out firing tonight, specifically taking aim at Ben Carson? What do you think?
I think he does. I think he takes shots at him. I don't know if he goes the religion route, but
he already has.
Yeah, he'll go the economic route, I guess. You know, I did a business. Ben hasn't done anything. Ben's a surgeon. Ben's this. Ben that. I think he will.
You think he will?
I don't know. I don't think it'll be right off the bat like Rand Paul, hey, Mr. 1% over there. Right. I don't think it's going to be anything like that. But
and you think it'll bode well for Donald Trump when he does that? You think it'll bode well? That's what people want to see.
People like it, but I don't know. This could be his strongest debate only because of what the topics are going to be.
Right. You
know,
you would expect it to be.
Yeah, they're going
to
stay away.
That's a huge disappointment. Huge.
Right. Correct. So, yeah, we'll see. I mean, whatever. We'll see. I want to know how Rubio does when it's not, because he shined in foreign policy and some other aspects. Let's see how he does when it comes down to the economics and, you know, business and whatever else they're going
to tonight. The return
to
of Cauley Fiorina, who after two great debates and a really good debate last time, where I thought she won going away. I thought she embarrassed, in fact, Donald Trump. She has been missing in action. I mean, she's on a milk carton since the last debate, and she's back on stage tonight. And you have to wonder if, in fact, she fares well again, what is she going to do on a daily basis to keep that momentum going?
Yeah, you're right, because it fell off. It was rolling for, what, two or three weeks? And then
rolling.
Bang. Then off a cliff.
Gone. Completely gone. So that is coming up tonight as well. And that sets up a really good guest list on the program today, starting at 7:30, about an hour from now. CNBC has tonight's debate. And Ron Insana, who's been at CNBC for 100 years, he is not good, he's great. Ron Insana stopping by at 7:30. Coming up at 8:45, week 8 of the NFL starts tomorrow night in Massachusetts, where the undefeated 6-0 New England Patriots will host your red-hot winners of two in a row, 3-3 Miami Dolphins. The voice of CBS Sports, whether it's football, college basketball, or the Masters, my dear friend Jim Nance stopping by. Yes, at 8:45, World Series Game 2, Mets and Royals later on tonight. Nobody has called more World Series games on television than the all-time great Tim McCarver. He'll be here at 9. And is that it for now? Maybe Sean Thornton of the Panthers?
Maybe.
Maybe. All right. Here is Gabe. Good morning, Gabriel.
Good morning, Sid. I have to address something that occurred right before you guys went off air yesterday.
All right.
Now, I do love Lengel. I would rip someone's ear off for him.
Here comes a shot. Okay, right.
But as, like, let's say we were related, we're like brothers or whatever, I would read him the riot act when I get pissed off at him. And yesterday, right before you guys get off here, I believe it was you and Z-Max said you both said go Mets.
That's right.
And right before it cuts off, you know how someone just gets so pissed they let off an uncomfortable giggle?
Yes, yes.
Lengel lets off this uncomfortable giggle as soon as you guys said, go Mets.
Right.
And I'm thinking to myself, this guy, he wants him to lose. You wanted him to lose so bad last night.
So bad.
Lengel. Get out of here.
You know,
no way.
You're not just a dick. You're a weapons-grade dick.
Oh, my God.
I love you, but you're definitely a weapons-grade dickhead.
Jesus.
Have a great day.
I think he's right, because
how do I take that?
You are rooting for the Royals.
I'm not rooting for the Royals.
Here's what he's doing.
He's not rooting for the Royals. Here's what he does. He loves to see you specifically miserable. He loves it.
Not at all.
So if it means Mets losing and puts you in a bad mood because you have to be good on radio then, he would rather see that than the Mets win. He wants to see an angry, great radio Steve Z-Mac rather than a Met win. That's what this comes down to. I know him. He's like, Z-Mac is going to be fired up, which you are, almost retarded, great, passionate, stupid, all that in one, and now he's got it. So I understand where Lengel is coming from.
What a dick.
I'm pulling for the Mets.
No, you're not.
This Royals team is scrappy, though. I mean, they are
scrappy, yes.
You're going to have to work for it.
And, as opposed to what?
Well, I mean, the sweeps are what?
Stop. Who cares about a sweep? You know, the
Cubs.
The parade remains the same whether you win it in 4, 5, 6, or 7.
Hey, look, they just need one. They need one of these first two.
Tonight. They win tonight.
Then
it's fine.
All good. Then
now, we lose tonight, then the Z-Mac I'm seeing this morning.
Then it's over.
That would be okay tomorrow. But the Z-Mac I'm seeing this morning right now is a bit silly, to be honest.
That hurt last night. That hurt.
Okay, move on. Let's move on. Now, the true passion is you move on. Let it go. Don't let it ruin your day. Tomorrow, if we're down 2-0, I promise I'll be the same one. But it's not going to be.
I don't want to be. I want to be 1-1.
It's going to be 1-1.
Cueto.
And I'll be very sympathetic.
If what?
If you come in after a loss. Tomorrow.
Why would you even say after a loss? Say after a win, blah, 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 blah. Now, after a loss. Don't go to worst case scenario.
Right.
After a possible win, yes.
After a likely win.
Thank you.
Yes.
Possible.
A probable victory.
Who's Syndergaard tomorrow?
DeGrom tonight.
Oh, DeGrom tonight.
Yes. Yep.
Okay.
And I have good news for you guys. I didn't find it good news, but yesterday I did read that Jacob's going to cut his hair after the...
I did see that, too. He looks like an idiot.
He looks like an idiot. No, I love it.
I know you love it. He looks like an idiot. On a serious note, though, how about the pitcher for the Royals last night? Starts the game, Edison Volquez, and has no idea that back home in the Dominican Republic, his father had passed away. And they did not tell him till after the game. He did leave the stadium, went right home to the DR, and according to the manager of the Royals, Ned Yost, they have no idea if and when he's coming back. So he pitches that game not even knowing that his dad had passed away. How about that?
And another bad job by ESPN because ESPN is tweeting. I mean, we're minutes away from the first pitch.
It was out there.
Yep, ESPN's tweet. Buster Olney is saying reports out of ESPN Deportes is that Volquez was told on his way to
the stadium
that his father had passed
away.
So
I'm watching this guy pitch the first inning. I'm watching every facial expression.
Same with me.
Right, saying, oh my God, this guy's out there throwing. His dad just died. And as it turns out, he had no idea.
I sent you a text. I'm like, Fox has not mentioned this yet. I was wondering why. And Joe Buck went on to explain it later that it was all the obviously the games were on in the clubhouse. They didn't want someone walking in and saying,
Your father died.
Yeah.
Right.
So Joe Buck, nice job by Fox, kept their mouth shut. And from what I found out later is that Volquez's wife went right to Ned Yost, right to the Royals, and said, do not let this get out.
Wow.
Do not let him know. Yeah. Keep him in a bubble.
His family made sure.
Let him go
was,
out there. And then there was an interaction that they showed, I guess, when Volquez found out. He would look like he was about to go into tears, and Ned Yost just pointing in the clubhouse like, you can get out of here.
Go home.
Go with your family, see what's going on. Jeez. And Royals came back and won the damn game. So.
There you go. So I'm a Met fan, but that's a nice story that the Royals came back and won for Edison, who did lose his father right before the start. So we got a big guest list today once again. Iran and Sana, CNBC, breaking down GOP debate number 3, live from Colorado tonight. The voice of CBS Sports, Jim Nance. Tim McCarver, the great baseball man, Tim McCarver, 844-640-6464, 844-640-6464. Back on a busy Wednesday right after this.
Welcome back to the Sid Rosenberg Show.
Oh, the Niners. The Niners. He had a big game against the Niners, but yeah, you're right. All right, buddy.
Wow, that hurt. I mean, I got to be honest.
Yeah,
my eyes are tearing.
You didn't look too good while that was going on.
That was a vomit burp. What exactly happens with a vomit burp that it automatically closes up your throat, right?
Like I don't know. You probably.
If I open my mouth during a vomit burp and I want to puke, can I do that?
Projectile would have landed in Lindell's face.
Oh, that would be great.
It's Sid Rosenberg on 640 Sports.
Listening back now to that did sound painful. And the best part of the whole thing is, here I am basically stroking out after a horrible vomit burp. And you're going on about the 49ers or something. You kept going on about San Francisco.
Well, imagine we were like live on like NBC News and that happened. I'd have to keep rolling with the news. So
is that
I was
what it
like,
was?
Yeah, I was like, hey, let me keep it going.
It
and then,
sounded so painful, too.
I thought you'd come back up for air, but you didn't.
No,
that's
no,
when I realized.
I'm like,
whoa, he's in trouble.
I had a shooting pain that went down my left arm to my ass. After the, let me get that burp one more time, if I can get that. If you can get that back for me. You can hear how violent that specific vomit burp was. It was horrible. No, that's later on in the burp. That was,
I think it just starts
it
right off.
It caused a choking episode.
The oof. The oof. The oof is like the acid, your stomach acid that's in your mouth, and you're swallowing it back down again.
That's Michael Kadire in my mouth.
Yes.
He's just stomach acid at this point. He's the worst player ever. When was the last time you had a vomit burp? Do you remember?
It happens every once in a while.
When was the last time? A violent one like that nearly caused you to stroke out.
I usually get them when I mix like pizza and beer.
Pizza and beer, right.
Like any type of marinara sauce with beer does not go well with me.
That's where you get the vomit burp.
Instant fire and, vomit burps.
More than, what about when you use the actual fire sauce at Taco Bell? What about that?
Nah, that's okay.
No.
That's
so
okay.
So pizza and beer for you causes a very violent vomit burp.
Violent.
What about you, Lengel? When do you get the old vomit burp?
Unfortunately, I get them in the middle of the night when I'm sleeping. And I almost choke on them.
Yeah, you could die.
Yeah, that's how Jimi Hendrix died.
No, Jimi Hendrix did not die.
He OD'd and
He did choke on his own vomit, yes.
Yeah, but he had like a needle in the roof of his mouth while he was doing that.
I didn't say what made him vomit. I'm just saying.
So what is Alicia doing?
She jumps up startled because I leap out of bed choking and I make a mad. I don't know where I'm running, but I take off running. I have to run. I can't stay. laying down on my back. Out of a dead sleep. It's not funny. It could be dangerous.
Oh my God!
How'd you like to wake up out of a dead sleep and you're choking on a
But what did you eat the night? Well, what would you eat the night before?
Usually, it's if I eat late, no matter what it is, right. And then I have a protein shake before bed.
Right. Well, protein shake attacks my ass.
It's
more than my esophagus. But for you,
well, it's so thick, and then I lay on my back, and it comes all up. And next thing I know, it's I'm choking on it. It's in my throat.
You know, it's funny you say that because Danielle says now and then I'll snore and then I'll also start to choke and it'll wake her up and she doesn't get nervous. She's like, okay, whatever. If he dies, he dies. But with you, you actually get up and start running through the house.
I wake up and I'm in a mad panic. I'm right out of the dead sleep. It's like a scene out of an Eli Roth movie. I'm crazed. And I make her.
Does Alicia get nervous?
Yeah, well, she wakes up. She goes, what's the matter? And I'm like, I can't even talk. I've got a throat full of protein powder and shake. And then I just take off running. I don't know where I'm going, but I can't sit still.
This is the greatest thing I've ever heard in my whole life. I swear to God it is.
And then finally, I choke it back down.
Right, that's it.
And then I
fine.
Can start breathing. But
you choke it back down.
Yeah.
That sounds.
Well, I don't throw it. I don't
so you
throw
can't
it
throw
up.
It out, right.
Yeah, I don't
right.
throw it up. That's, right. Protein is expensive.
Right, of course.
Projectile. It's good for the dog will lick it up.
No. I'll end up cleaning it up.
Oh, my God.
So well, you know, unfortunately, that's when I have mine.
You know what this conversation comes down to is it sucks getting old. You're going to be 49.
Yes.
I'm going to be 49. And the both of us suffer from, we choke in our sleep, both of us. We have a horrible vomit burps. And you nearly die a couple of times. That's just getting old.
We can't have a dry bowel movement.
Never. I wipe my ass 30 times a day, and if I make once, I'm lucky. If I fart once, I got to wipe like the next 3 hours. And then I go through rolls of toilet paper.
Yes.
Like you would go through a...
that's true.
Underwear.
Yes.
Rolls of it.
I agree. I'm right with you, unfortunately.
Horrible. That's the worst feeling of all.
And we're only 48.
49. Well, we'll be 49. Yeah, what happens when you're like 60? Well, you know what the difference is? You don't care anymore. But you don't care at that point.
Yeah, like Michael Kadire. You don't care.
Right. Michael Kadire. Exactly. He always comes up. You see, we're at the age now where we still look good. And so there's still some pride left, if you will. Oh, God, here we go again.
Oh.
By the time you get to 60, 65, you just don't care.
That's true, yeah.
You play shuffleboard, you make duty in your pants, and it doesn't matter. Nobody cares. You get to see Ricky at 4:30 in the afternoon, have yourself some fajita bowl and a salad and a Diet Coke for $6. Go home and watch Lester Holt. And if you're lucky, Viagra, you may get a little action. If not, you go to bed. And that's it. And that's your life. And then you die. And you come to Florida, of course, but we came earlier to die.
Well, this is the right place for it. You can do it comfortably here
right.
and warm.
Exactly, yeah. Well, Carmelo Anthony came out today, and yesterday he said, F New York. He said, now starting his sixth year with the Knickerbockers, the Knicks open up their season tonight in Milwaukee against the Bucks. Heat will host the Bobcats. Carmelo Anthony said, I don't care how much you love New York. I don't care if you're the mailman, the governor, or the mayor. I don't care how much you love New York. New Yorkers get up many times throughout the year and say, F New York. He's really right about that. Because when I live there, and nobody loves New York more than me, nobody misses New York more than me. When I live there, I would mother F New York every day. The weather, the traffic. I'd be like, F this. Get me out of here. Now I'm gone, of course. Now I'm dying to get back. But I'd be upping New York every single day. Carmelo admitted, he goes, when you're winning and things are great, this is a great place. He goes, when things are down in this city, F New York. It's fair.
Yeah, yeah.
Nobody says F Boca. Nobody cares.
Well, they do sometimes when you're sitting at the light of...
Sitting at the light at the Glades Road. Or,
and some guy with a sign is staring in your window.
Go to a city fish market, got to wait an extra 20 minutes to sit down and have a piece of halibut. That's a horrible thing. Horrible thing.
The Boys is pretty rough, although that's Del Rey.
I wouldn't go there anymore.
Yeah,
I was nearly killed not once but twice in that parking lot.
Probably by an 85-year-old lady,
that's exactly
too.
The place is great. They got the freshest fruit. It is a wonderful place. But you take your life into your hands in that parking lot every single time. I think the last time I was there, it may have been for my son's bris, Gabriel, or Ava's part, something. And I swear to God, I got out. It was like Afghanistan. I was like, thank God I made it out alive.
No, they should have a patrol officer around there taking names and barring these old people from coming back.
Yeah, they all come from Kings Point.
Yes, right up the street. And they,
First of all, the line to get in is ridiculous, and then in the parking lot is ridiculous. You can get killed
there.
And they
start yelling.
Then they ram you with
the
cars once you get inside.
My sister did, taking pictures of the wedding on Saturday. Oh, some old guy yells at you. I'm like, what are you going to do? You're going to punch him out? He's 85 years old. I've been yelled at the boys more than once.
No, I know. That. And they hit you with the card, and you look up. You're like, hey. They're like, move.
Right.
Sounds a lot like Pines.
Oh, God.
Just for different reasons.
Really? What happens in Pembroke Pines?
Well, there's a little strip mall kind of shopping center across the street from my house.
Right.
It's literally about,
what's in
I'd
that
say
mall? Give me some of the Pines stores.
There's a Publix there. Right. There's
good.
A Subway. There's a Nutrition
good.
Smart.
Oh, my God. Look at this.
Let's see. A Walmart. Super
tremendous.
Walmart.
Tremendous.
So, but it's literally about 100 yards from my apartment complex. And to go there and get anything done, you're talking about an hour.
An hour.
An hour. Traffic, yeah. People cutting you off.
Old people though, basically.
Not here. Well, Century Village is not too far away, but
yeah.
I just know what – it's the Pembroke Pines ignorant driver.
Well,
it is
widely known.
The traffic.
It is and I don't mean to offend anybody when I say this, but it is widely known that the three worst drivers are old people, Hasidim, and women. My wife happens to be a very good driver, but old people, Hasidim, and women – can't drive.
In Pines, I just think, I don't know if anyone
wait.
Knows the rules of the road.
Right.
List that again.
Old people.
Yes.
Hasidim. Right. And women.
Now, none of those three are allowed to drive in Saudi Arabia, just saying.
Is that true?
Well, maybe they know something, yes. Yeah, I mean.
Well, there you have it. All right, big guest list coming up. Ron Insana, CNBC. GOP debate number 3 on CNBC later on tonight. Jim Nantz, big-time guest today, the voice of CBS Sports. And an even bigger guest, baseball's Tim McCarver. Monster Day coming up, 844-640-6464. Back on a busy Wednesday, right after this.
Welcome back to the Sid Rosenberg Show.
What's your favorite ballad, Elephant Boy? Your favorite slow love song? Your favorite ballad?
Guns N' Roses, Patience.
What? Is that Guns N' Roses, Patience?
Guns N' Roses, Patience.
Okay, all right, here we go.
Set the choppy home soon. I miss you. So I can't even think of the words now. I can't do it. I'm sorry, Sid.
It's Sid Rosenberg on 640 Sports.
Nothing left inside of me. And maybe you can cry all night, but that'll never change the way that I feel. The snow is really piling up outside. I wish you wouldn't make me leave here. I poured it.
You've been cold. God, Meatloaf was great, wasn't he? Yes. Late 1970s, upstate New York camp, Stinky Finger. We all got it, right?
What?
So my daughter's in the car right now. I owe my daughter Ava an apology.
Oh, boy.
Well, these things happen.
What happened?
Why are you so...
I remember this particular moment in the show yesterday. It kind of stuck with me.
It did. Well, if it stuck with you and you remember the moment so well...
Right.
My daughter Ava,
yes.
In the car now, on the way to the box.
Yes.
Tell me what the whole thing centered around.
Well, I believe she sent you a text, blaming you for something.
More than one text.
Right. Okay. And well, blaming you for, I don't know, not putting a something for her tennis, an ID or something?
You're very close. Her school ID was inside her tennis bag.
Ah.
I picked her up from tennis two nights ago, took her home, and she claimed, my daughter Ava, that she said, Daddy, if you wouldn't mind when you come back inside, because she exited the car first, please take the bag back in.
Okay.
I said yesterday she never asked me to do that. Mm-hmm. Therefore, she left the bag inside the car, and it's her responsibility. And I basically called her a liar.
Well, that's what it sounded like. Yeah. You were angry.
I was very angry.
Right. Okay.
Well, as it turns out, this is shocking.
Boy.
This is shocking.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy, what?
Oh, go ahead. I'm just listening.
This is shocking.
It's shocking.
As it turns out, in defense of Ava, she did, in fact, ask me.
How does it come to you? Because at the moment, you would swear
I
up and down.
I was so cocksure. Right. It's so cool I can say that,
yes,
cocksure.
You were.
I was so cocksure that she hadn't asked me. And I swear to God, I took her home last night from tennis. I was going to get her at tennis. I looked in the back seat of the car. I saw the tennis bag. I'm like, you know what?
Oh,
it just came back to me.
This poor girl.
It just.
What did you...
She did, in fact, ask me. I did say yes. Now, at the time, I was in a very, very important text conversation with Steve Zemach.
Oh, my God. About
because
what,
I think he's got another sty in his eye. So we were discussing these things, and therefore, I forgot.
He's got another sty in his eye.
I thought he did, yes. He's got some type of...
He's been washing his eye with baby shampoo
right,
for years.
Right, with whale sperm. Oh, so anyway, geez. I was wrong, and I apologize to my sweet, beautiful, loving, brilliant, great daughter. I mean all those words sincerely. She's a great kid. Both of my kids, Ava and Gabriel. I'm blessed. I really am blessed.
Oh, I hope she doesn't accept it right away.
Well, you see, this is why you say things like this. And I'm forced to tell you that I first apologized in person yesterday.
Right. Oh,
and
okay.
She was very happy, gladly accepted it, and said, "I love you, Daddy."
She didn't demand this public apology.
She did, actually, yes.
She did? Oh, yeah. Good
she,
for
she
her.
She said, you embarrassed me on the radio yesterday.
Right, I would like her to stand up for herself.
Right, well, she did. So be quiet. It's like, shut up.
So horrible
God.
And so cool.
I was angry. I thought I was being blamed. But look, it's not as if I don't get blamed for stuff that's not my fault.
It's one thing to forget that you asked, but then it comes back to you.
Yes, it came back to me. These things happen. It's like a delay, like the radio show. We're on a 7-second delay. Sometimes my conversations could be as long as a 23-hour delay. So I apologize. I felt horrible about it.
Okay.
Well, no, I'm not apologizing to you, dickface.
No, I'm glad.
I feel like I'm apologizing to you. Well, this is Ava, not you. God. What is this? Whoopi Goldberg? You jumped into a body like in the movie Ghost?
Not at all. I just...
Don't worry about it. It's none of your business. You just happen to be on the mic with me, so I'm sharing the story, but this is for Ava, not you.
Okay.
Look how happy you are.
I'm enjoying.
I can't wait to have to apologize for something, which will be any day now. You'll have something up. You'll have something up. You'll have to apologize, and I'll take the same glee that you're taking right now.
I'm not taking glee.
I apologize to Ava. I was wrong. To see you now, Z-Mac.
You're so adamant that you weren't wrong either.
I swear to God.
But wait, I got to defend Ava here because you ripped into her. Then you took a 30-second break, and then he went in and ripped Ava again.
Like, I didn't remember.
Two different occasions.
Oh, my God.
Thank you, Z-Meg. I forgot about the second piling on.
Ava's not here to defend herself. I feel like I'm her voice.
I was actually even more pissed at the break after you got off the air. I'm like,
I know.
Little brat, leave me alone. Jesus Christ.
Trying to do a radio show.
Right. I'm trying to do a goddamn radio show. It's hard enough.
I knew Ava could not be in the wrong. I knew that.
That's
I didn't want to say
that's what
that.
Danielle's like, she never lies. I go, you're right. She doesn't lie. You're right. I thought she was mistaken. Mistaken.
She doesn't lie.
But of
lie.
Course, it wasn't Ava was mistaken. It was Daddy.
I thought Danielle had convinced you that you asked. Like with the Jedi mind trick.
She you know what? She stayed out of it, which is
really?
Good.
Really? Oh, that is
You got to stay out of it.
No, that was good.
She knew I was wrong. Trust me. But she stayed out of it.
Really? So. Even knowing you were wrong.
Yes.
Well, that says a lot about it.
That's a good parent.
Yes, that's good.
Because if you get in the way, then it's like, you know, you can't do that. You got like one parent. And
you can't
as it turns
undermine
out,
the other parent.
Well, I screwed up, so.
Yes, you did.
Right. Shut up.
What?
Jesus Christ.
Sorry.
My God.
Oof.
You know, I remember that one time when Nick said, you know, my stepfather, Langell, he's really an asshole. And I never told you about that.
What?
Your stepson, yes.
No.
At the house at dinner that night.
No.
I said, how do you really
you
feel about,
know.
About Eric, your
you
stepfather?
You wouldn't say that.
That's exactly what he said. I think he said raging asshole, to be honest. So.
Raging?
Yes.
That's not
even
like
worse.
That's not like Nick.
But I wasn't going to tell you that and hurt your feelings. But
well, now
you force me.
because you're taking such glee with Ava that he never said that. He loves you. And Ava loves me, so.
Yes, she does. I know that.
Just you don't know that.
Kids
you
always forgive their parents when they're wrong. They've got an indomitable spirit. You can't break them.
They've got a what?
An indomitable spirit.
You want to spell that?
No. Even though I might be close.
You want to tell us exactly what that word means?
Unbeatable.
See, like, is he right?
You can't hold him down.
Weren't you an English major or something?
Unstoppable.
Is that right? Unstoppable. Yeah. Is that right?
The indomitable spirit of man.
What about the indomitable snowman?
No.
He never melts.
It wasn't the indomitable snowman, was it?
No.
What was it?
I think it's that's the defensive tackle for the Dolphins, the indomitable Sue.
Oh, that's what it is, right?
Yeah, something like that.
All right, so we got that out of the way. Abe, I'm sorry. We got, once again, we got a great show. Ron and Santa, Tim McCarver, Jim Nance, a host of others, back with the 7 o'clock hour right after this.